This video, I'm actually going to be reading an excerpt from a speech from a TED Talk. This is called We Should All Be Feminists. And this right here is the author of the speech. I won't try to say her name because I don't want to offend anybody or say it. Was un-African, I decided I would now call myself a happy African feminist. Then a dear friend told me that calling myself a feminist meant that I hated men, so I decided I would now be a happy African feminist who does not hate men. At some point, I was a happy African feminist who does not hate men and who likes to wear lip gloss and high heels for herself and not for men. Of course, much of this was tongue-in-cheek, but what it shows is how is so heavy with baggage, negative baggage. You hate men, you hate bras, you hate African culture. You think women should always be in charge. You don't wear makeup, you don't shave, you're always angry. You don't have a sense of humor, you don't use deodorant. Now here's a story from my childhood. When I was in primary school in Suka, it's spelled N-S-U-K-K-A, a university town in South Nigeria, my mother said at the beginning of term that she would give the class a test, and whoever got the highest score would be the class monitor. Class monitor was a big deal. Most important attribute for survival. this automatic assumption is that a Nigerian female walking into a hotel alone is a sex worker. Because a Nigerian female alone cannot possibly be a guest paying for her own room. A man who walks into the same hotel is not harassed. The assumption is that he is there for something legitimate. Why, by the way, do those hotels not focus on the demand for sex workers instead of ostensible supply? In Lagos, I cannot go alone into many reputable clubs and bars. They just don't let you in if you are a woman alone. You must be accompanied by a man. And so I have a male friend. I have male friends who arrive at clubs and end up going in with their arms linked with those of a complete stranger, because that complete stranger, a woman out on her own, had no choice but to ask for help to get into the club. Each time I walk into a Nigerian restaurant with a man, the waiter greets the man and ignores me. The waiters are products of a society that has taught them that men are more important than women, and I know that they don't intend harm. But it is one thing to know something intellectually, and quite another to feel it emotionally. Each time they ignore me, I feel invisible. I feel upset. I want to tell them that I am just as human as the man, just as worthy of acknowledgement. These are little things, but sometimes it is the little things that sting the most. Not long ago, I wrote an article about being young and female in Lagos, and an acquaintance told me that it was an angry article, and I should not have made it so angry. But I was unapologetic. Of course it was angry. Gender as it functions today is a grave injustice. I am angry. We should all be angry. Anger has a long history of bringing about positive change. But I am so hopeful because I believe deeply in the ability of human beings to remake themselves for the better. But back to anger. I heard the caution in the acquaintance tone, and I knew that the comment was as much about the article as it was about my character. Anger, the tone said, is particularly not good for a woman. If you are a woman, you are not supposed to express anger because it is threatening. I have a friend, an American woman, who took over a managerial position from a man. Her predecessor had been considered a tough go-getter. He was blunt and hard-charging and was particularly strict about the signing of timesheets. She took on her new job and imagined herself equally tough, but perhaps a little kinder than him. He didn't always realize that people had families, she said, and she did. Only weeks into her new job, she disciplined an employee about a forgery on a timesheet, just as her predecessor would have done. The employee then complained to top management about her style. She was aggressive and difficult to work with, the employee said. Other employees agreed. One said they had expected that she would bring a woman's touch to her job, but she hadn't. It didn't occur to any of them that she was doing the same thing for which a man had been praised. I have another friend, also an American woman, who has a high-paying job in advertising. She's one of two women in her team. Once at a meeting, she said she had felt slighted by her boss, who had ignored her comments and then praised something similar when it came from a man. She wanted to speak up to challenge her boss. She wanted, but she didn't. Instead, after the meeting, she went to the bathroom and cried, then called me to vent about it. She didn't want to speak up because she didn't want to seem aggressive. She let her resentments simmer. What struck me with her and with many other female American friends I have is how invested they are in being liked. How they have been raised to believe that their being likable is very important, and that this likable trait is a specific thing, and that specific thing does not include showing anger or being aggressive or disagreeing too loudly. We spend too much time teaching girls to worry about what boys think of them, but the reverse is not the case. We don't teach boys to care about being likable. We spend much time telling girls that they cannot be angry or aggressive or tough, which is bad enough, but then we turn around and either praise or excuse men for the same reasons. All over the world, there are so many magazine articles and books telling women what to do, how to be and not to be, in order to attract or please men. There are far fewer guides for men about pleasing women. I teach a writing workshop in Lagos, and one of the participants, a young woman, told me that a friend had told her not to listen to my feminist talk. Otherwise, she would absorb ideas that would destroy her marriage. This is a threat to destruction. Let's see. This is a threat to destruction of a marriage, the possibility of not having a marriage at all. The inner society is much more likely to be all used against a woman than against a must raise our daughters differently. We must also raise our sons differently. We do a great disservice to boys in how we raise them. We stifle the humanity of boys. We define masculinity in a very narrow way. Masculinity is a hard, small cage, and we put boys inside this cage. We teach boys to be afraid of fear, of weakness, of vulnerability. We teach them to mask their true selves because they have to be, in Nigerian speak, a hard man. In secondary school, a boy and girl go out, both of them teenagers with meager pocket money, yet the boy is expected to pay the bills always to prove his masculinity, and we wonder why boys are more likely to steal from their parents. What if boys and girls are raised not to link masculinity and money? What if their attitude was not the boy has to pay, but rather whoever has more should pay? Of course, because of their historical advantage, it is mostly men who will have more today. But if we start raising children differently, then in 50 years, in 100 years, boys will no longer have the pressure of proving their masculinity by material means. But by far the worst thing we do to males, by making them feel they have to be hard, is that we leave them with very fragile egos. The harder a man feels compelled to be, the weaker his ego is. And then we do a much greater disservice to girls because we raise them to cater to the fragile egos of males. We teach girls to shrink themselves, to make themselves smaller. We say to girls, you can have ambition, but not too much. You should aim to be successful, but not too successful. Otherwise, you will threaten the man. If you are the breadwinner in your relationship with a man, pretend that you are not, especially in public. Otherwise, you will emasculate him. But what if we question the premise itself? Why should a woman's success be a threat to a man? What if we decide to simply dispose of that word? And I don't know if there is an English word I dislike more than this. Emasculation. A Nigerian acquaintance once asked me if I was worried that men should be intimidated by me. I was not worried at all. It had not even occurred to me to be worried, because a man who would be intimidated by me is exactly the kind of man I would have no interest in. Still, I was struck by this, because I am female, I'm expected to aspire to marriage. I'm expected to make my life choices, always keeping in mind that marriage is the most important. Marriage can be a good thing, a source of joy, love, and mutual support. But why do we teach girls to aspire to marriage, yet we don't teach boys to do the same? I know a Nigerian woman who decided to sell her house because she didn't want to intimidate a man who might want to marry her. I know an unmarried woman in Nigeria who, when she goes to conferences, wears a wedding ring because she wants her colleagues to, according to her, give her respect. The sadness in this is that a wedding ring will indeed automatically make her seem worthy of respect, while not wearing a wedding ring would make her easily dismissible, and this isn't a modern workplace. I know young women who are under so much pressure from family, from friends, even from work, to get married that they are pushed to make terrible choices. Our society teaches a woman at a certain age who is unmarried to see it as a deep personal failure, while a man at a certain age who is unmarried has not quite come around to making his pick. It's easy to say, but women can just say no to all this, but the reality is more difficult. More complex. We are all social beings. We internalize ideas from our socialization. Even the language we use illustrates this. The language of marriage is often a language of ownership, not a language of partnership. We use the word respect for something a woman shows a man, but not often for something a man shows a woman. Both men and women will say, I did it for peace in my marriage. When men say it, it is usually about something they should not be doing anyway. Something they say to their friends in a fondly exasperated way. Something that ultimately proves to them their masculinity. Oh, my wife said I can't go to clubs every night, so now for peace in my marriage, I go only on weekends. When women say I did it for peace in my marriage, it is usually because they have given up a job, a career goal, a dream. We teach females that in relationships, compromise is what a woman is more likely to do. We raise girls to see each other as competitors, not for jobs or accomplishments, which in my opinion can be a good thing, but for the attention of men. We teach girls that they cannot be sexual beings in the way boys are. If we have sons, we don't mind knowing about their girlfriends, but our daughters Yes, rape is wrong, but what is a girl doing in her room with four boys? Let us, if we can, forget the horrible inhumanity of that response. These Nigerians have been raised to think of woman as inherently guilty. They have been raised to expect so little of men that the idea of men as savage beings with no self-control is somehow acceptable. We teach girls shame. Close your legs. Cover yourself. We make them feel as though by being born female they are already guilty of something. And so girls grow up to be women who cannot say they have desire, who silence themselves. We cannot say what they truly think, who have turned pretense into an art form. I know a woman who hates domestic work, but she pretends that she likes it because she has been taught to be good wife material. She has to be, to use that Nigerian word, homely. And then she got married, and her husband's family began to complain that she had changed. Actually, she had not changed. She had just got tired of pretending to be what she was not. The problem with gender is that it prescribes how we should be rather than recognizing how we are. Imagine how much happier we would be, how much freer to be our truer individual selves if we didn't have the weight of gender expectations. Boys and girls are undeniably different biologically, but socialization exaggerates the differences and then starts a self-fulfilling process. Take cooking, for example. Today, women in general are more likely to do housework than men, cooking and cleaning. But why is that? Is it because women are born with a cooking gene, or because over the years they have been socialized to see cooking as their role? I was going to say that perhaps women are born with a cooking gene until I remembered that the majority of famous cooks in the world who are given the fancy title of chef are men. I used to look at my grandmother, a brilliant woman, and wonder what she would have been if she'd had the same opportunities as men during her youth. Today, there are more opportunities for women than there were during my grandmother's time because of changes in policy and law, which are very important. But what matters even more is our attitude, our mindset. What if in raising children we focus on ability instead of gender? What if we focus on interest instead of gender? I know a family who has a son and a daughter, a year apart age, both brilliant at school. When the boy's hungry, the parents say to the girl, go and cook indomie noodles for your brother. The girl doesn't like to cook indomie noodles, but she is a girl. She has to. What if the parents from the beginning taught both children to cook them? Cooking, by the way, is a useful and practical life skill for a boy to have. I've never thought it made much sense to leave such a crucial thing, the ability to nourish oneself in the hands of others. I know a woman who has the same degree and same job as her husband. When they get back from work, she does most of the housework, which is true for many marriages. But what struck me was that whenever he changed the baby's nappy, she said thank you to him. What if she saw it as something natural, that he should help care for his child? I am trying to unlearn many lessons of gender I internalized while growing up, but I sometimes still feel vulnerable in the face of gender expectations. The first time I taught a writing class in graduate school, I was worried, not about the teaching material, because I was well prepared and I was teaching what I enjoyed. Instead, I was worried about what to wear. I wanted it to be taken seriously. I knew that because I was female, I would automatically have to prove my worth, and I was worried that I looked too feminine. I would not be taken seriously. I really wanted to wear my shiny lip gloss and my curly skirt, but I decided not to. I wore a very serious, very manly, and very ugly suit. The sad truth of the matter is that when it comes to appearance, we start off with men as a standard, as the norm. Many of us think that the less feminine a woman appears, the more likely she is to be taken seriously. A man going to a business meeting doesn't wonder about being taken seriously based on what he is wearing, but a woman does. I wish I had not worn that ugly suit that day. Had I then the confidence I have now to be myself, my students would have benefited even more from my teaching, because I would have been more comfortable and more fully and truly myself. I have chosen to no longer be apologetic for my femininity, and I want to be respected in all my femaleness, because I deserve to be. I like politics and history, and I'm happiest when having a good argument about ideas. I am girly. I'm happily girly. I like high heels and try on lipsticks. It's nice to be complimented by both men and women, although I have to be honest and say that I prefer the compliments of stylish women, but I often wear clothes that men don't like or don't understand. I wear them because I like them and because I feel good in them. The male gaze conversation to have. It makes people uncomfortable, sometimes even irritable. Both men and women are resistant to talk about gender or are quick to dismiss the problems of gender because thinking of changing the status quo is always uncomfortable. Some people ask why the word feminist, why not just say you are a believer in human rights or something like that? Because that would be dishonest. Feminism is, of course, part of human rights in general, but to use the vague expression human rights is to deny the specific and particular problem of gender. It would be a way of pretending that it was not women who have, for centuries, been excluded. It would be a way of denying that the problem of gender targets women, that the problem was not about being human, but specifically about being a female human. For centuries, the world divided human beings into two groups, and then proceeded to exclude and oppress one group. It is only fair that the solution to the problem should acknowledge that. Some men feel threatened by the idea of feminism. This comes, I think, from the insecurity triggered by how boys are brought up. Their sense of self-worth is diminished if they are not naturally in charge as men. Other men might respond by saying, okay, this is interesting, but I don't think like that. I don't even think about gender. Maybe not. And that is part of the problem, that many men do not actively think about gender or notice gender. That many men say, like my friend Louis did, that many things might have been bad in the past, but everything is fine now. And that many men do not. Men do nothing to change it. If you are a man and you walk into a restaurant and the waiter greets just you, does it occur to you to ask the waiter, why have you not greeted her? Men need to speak out in all of these ostensibly small situations. Because gender can be uncomfortable, there are easy ways to close this conversation. Some people will bring up evolutionary biology and apes, how female apes bow to male apes, that sort of thing. But the point is this, we are not apes. Apes also live in trees and eat earthworms. We do not. Some people will say, well, poor men also have a hard time. And they do. But that is not what this conversation is about. Gender and class are different. Poor men still have the privileges of being men, even if they do not have the privileges of being wealthy. I learned a lot about systems of oppression and how they can be blind to one another by talking to black men. I was once talking about gender and a man said to me, why does it have to be you as a woman? Why not you as a human being? This type of question is a way of silencing a person's specific experiences. Of course, I am a human being, but there are particular things that happen to me in the world because I am a woman. This same man, by the way, would often talk about his experience as a black man, to which I should probably have responded, why not your experiences as a man or as a human being? Why a black man? So no, this conversation is about gender. Some people say, oh, but women have the real power, bottom power. This is a Nigerian expression for a woman who uses her sexuality to get things from men. But bottom power is not power at all, because a woman with bottom power is actually not powerful. She just has a good route to tap another person's power. And then what happens if the man is in a bad mood or sick or temporarily impotent? Some people will say a woman is subordinate to men because it's our culture, but culture is constantly changing. I have beautiful twin nieces who are 15. If they had been born 100 years ago, they would have been taken away and killed. Because 100 years ago, Igbo culture considered the birth of twins to be an evil omen. Today, that practice is unimaginable to all Igbo people. What is the point of culture? Culture functions ultimately to ensure the preservation and continuity of a people. In my family, I am the child who is most interested in the story of who we are, in ancestral lands, in our tradition. My brothers are not as interested as I am, but I cannot participate because Igbo culture privileges men and only the male members of the extended family can attend the meetings where major family decisions are taken. So although I am the only one who is most interested in these things, I cannot attend the meeting. I cannot have a formal say because I am a female. Culture does not make people. People make culture. If it is true that the full humanity of woman is not our culture, then we can and must make it our culture. I think very often of my friend Okoloma. May he and others who passed away in that Sosoliso crash continue to rest in peace. He will always be remembered by those of us who loved him. And he was right that day, many years ago, when he called me a feminist. I am a feminist. Didn't crack or anything too much. My voice.